Okay. Ashley, are you all set?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, welcome everybody to the Positive Behavioral Interventions in Community Settings Family Caregiving Series, aka Our Parent Cafes. Reminder to mute yourself because it says you're muted, but you're not. I did not set that setting this time, so mute yourself just in case there's background noise. Like I know I will in a couple of minutes, one of my dogs will bark. So make sure you do that. But keep your camera on. We like to see you guys being engaged and having fun with us. So thank you so much for being a part of that. I want to remind everybody that this is brought to you by the Kansas Children's Cabinet and Trust Fund through an all-in for Kansas Kids Quality Subgrant. This is the final of our presentations for this series. We can go to the next slide. So we want to know, who are you? Your name, your organization, who you're affiliated with. If you're a parent, just say parent. If you're from an organization that deals with teaching and or working with children, put that as well. That helps us out for our grant tracking purposes. Our host today is ourselves at IBT, Integrated Behavioral Technologies, and the Kids Place, with support from the University of Kansas Medical Center, Dr. Linda Heitzman Powell. And our presenter today is Ashley Bennett. Very happy to have her. Now, this is a draft agenda, which basically means it's just a draft. We want you guys to know we're introing now, but the presentation and talking with Ashley is more of a conversation. So please just feel free to ask at any time any questions, as opposed to at the end of group discussion. We really want this to be more interactive. And Ashley has even mentioned that she can give the presentation, but it's much more fun just to have a discussion amongst everybody based on her information. All right, Ash. The next slide. Now, the purpose today is to improve training and ensure that we're meeting our community's needs based on your feedback, which means at the end of this presentation, you'll get an email. You'll have a survey to fill out, takes less than 2 minutes, very similar if you did the one to sign up for today's event. That also helps for our PBS series. Included in that email also will be a copy of Ashley's presentation, as well as the link to our website, which you can watch it at any time from the page that it's on. And without further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce to you for her presentation today, Ashley Bennett. She is a licensed behavior analyst in Kansas and Missouri, and a board-certified behavioral analyst. She's developed a passion for helping children at the University of Kansas, where she encountered Intro to Applied Behavioral Analysis in her undergraduate program. Through her studies, Ashley was excited to find a combination of scientific principles and helping children and families with ABA. So without further ado, Ashley, please take it over, and we are so happy to have you today.
Hey, everybody. I'm really excited to do this presentation. As my kind of bio said, I developed a passion for ABA and really learning about why humans do what they do and why people do what they do at an intro to ABA class. I was kind of sold ever since and have just been loving working with kids and helping families work through hard behaviors, work through trying to gain some skills. I spend most of my day working with kids on the autism spectrum and their families, but absolutely cut my ABA teeth in preschool settings and even in an infant toddler setting, which blew my mind that you can apply some of these things even to infants and really help them thrive and grow in new and exciting ways. This is just a slide about trying to mitigate any potential bias that I'm presenting. The evidence based, or what I'm presenting, is based on currently accepted evidence in my profession. Obviously, those things can change because, as science does, sometimes we get new evidence and we have to admit, oh, we found something new that changes what we thought we knew. On my agenda, and as John said, interrupt me if you have a question. Just go ahead and ask it. I'd much rather have a conversation. I can sit here and fill the entire hour of talking because I'm pretty good at that. But I think you guys will get more out of it and might enjoy it more if you've got specific things you want to talk about and we can break them down together as a group. My agenda is just, are we going to be able to answer some of these questions? The first one, I'm being a little silly on purpose because of course, children are people, right? We'll get there. I forgot this one comes up next, but we're our grants through a PBS model. And so most of what I'm going to talk about today is going to be in this green section, the primary prevention, how things relate to kids in general, how humans behave in general. But then if we get into more specific questions about certain behaviors, about certain developmental milestones, or really how do we tackle more significant behaviors, we can move up into those secondary or tertiary areas of the PBS model. Okay, so are children people? Yes, of course they're people, right? The reason I ask is because if you are a parent, a primary caregiver of kids, especially young ones, it can be easy to forget sometimes that they are people. They're not tiny adults, right? They're at their own developmental level, their own particular place in life and in the development of their brain, but they are people. And it can be easy to forget because we are spending so much of our time trying to keep them alive, keep them healthy, get them to all of their social activities. Because as when they're young, right, that's the, you've got to make sure they eat and sleep and that all of their needs are met and that you've, if they're really little, you've got tummy time, you've got all these scheduled things you're supposed to be doing with your kids all the time. And it can feel like a job. It can feel like I am required but through my job as a parent caregiver to make sure all of these things happen at a certain time and forget that that's another person, right? As they begin to age, you become more of the social director. They're better able to care for themselves in some ways, but in other ways, you're still having to tackle a lot of really complicated things as parents or caregivers of children. And so as they get older, their brains are developing more. We've got a whole bunch of new skills, but also we've got a lot of new problems to tackle. And parents and caregivers are busy, right? Most of us are going to have jobs. Most of us are going to have other family responsibilities, other household tasks we're expected to do. And on top of all of that, you're also trying to do the best for kids. It's a big task. It's really, really big. And I want to acknowledge that everything that I say or recommend today, please know that if it sounds easy, I know that it's not. I know that a lot of the stuff that I'm going to talk about sounds simple, but when you really put it into practice, especially if they're your own kids, if you're going to try and apply something with your own children or grandchildren, that there is a lot of relationship that goes into that. And it's hard. It's hard for me to remember to apply the things that I know with my own children at home. So it's one thing to have this knowledge. It's one thing to know why people do what they do and how I can help them do things. And it's another to do it right all the time. Okay, times have changed. I want to put in a caveat that a lot of us were parented in ways that were accepted for the time, but now are either socially unacceptable or downright illegal. There are a lot of things with the way adults today were raised as kids that are just no longer acceptable in our society for one reason or another. And I'm not gonna break all of these down unless somebody's really interested in each one. I just wanted to kind of put this out there that there are a lot of parents right now, myself included, who are trying to pave a new path in parenting, who are trying to raise their kids in a way different from the way they were raised. And what we'll find out as we go through this is that we all learn from the way things have been modeled for us. So we are all having to learn as we go instead of just repeating what we learned from our parents. So it's difficult and it's really, really challenging. The older styles of parenting there are at the top, the authoritarian, that'd be kind of the drill sergeant. Kids will be seen and not heard. You will follow my directions because I said so. The permissive parent is going to kind of let everything slide. It doesn't, that's fine. That's fine. It's totally fine that they're drawing on the television. That would be the permissive style. And all of these do still exist. I say they're the old way of parenting. They were the old accepted ways of parenting, but because a lot of adults today were parented in these styles, there are still parents out there who are parenting the way their parents did. So those of you who are working with kids may encounter parents who parent in one of these styles and who move through styles. It's not necessarily that anybody sticks to one completely. The uninvolved parent, maybe too busy or really just emotionally unavailable. It can be one or the other, really. It's not to the level of neglect, that's different. But this would be the parent that's just, oh, you know, I've been at work all day and I can't be bothered to deal with my kids right now. The game's on. I gotta watch the football game daily, if that's kind of the daily parenting style of, well, I'm present, but not emotionally, or my attention is not present. That'd be the uninvolved parent. Authoritative is the parent that tries to walk the line between all of these, where we have some flexibility for the kids. We let some things go, but we also set some boundaries in place. We also make sure that they understand there are rules and expectations. Modern parenting, there's a lot. I'm not sure that we've landed on even solid terms for some of these yet, but some of them you've probably heard of: the helicopter parent, the one that's constantly hovering and trying to protect and trying to make sure everything's okay all the time. Scaffolding, conscious, respectful, and positive parenting are all other new modern parenting styles that are really kind of just coming out of, I think, a lot of this generational shift where parents are trying to change the way they're parenting. I just thought this was funny. How fun it is to care for small children is inversely proportional to how many other things you're trying to get done at the same time. Super fun to play with a toddler if you're not also trying to clean the house or give a Zoom presentation. I have a question, and I don't really have an answer to this question. What do you think is most important in caring for children with modern parenting and caregiving? And I'm just checking the chat to see if anybody's got thoughts on.
So Ashley, I have read, I'm not saying this is my opinion, I've read that attention and love, right? We're all distracted by technology these days. And I've read several articles that just say just one-on-one attention, like 10 minutes a day, just one-on-one time is the best thing you could do for your child. Again, that's what I've read. So that's my answer.
Yeah. That's kind of coming from it sounds like the conscious parenting that's down there in the modern one, where it's really being conscious about being present. Mm-hmm. They're like, yeah, I was with my kids all evening, but was I on my phone?
But was I? Yeah.
Right. Was I scrolling through emails trying to get one last thing done? Yeah. Was I really present, or was I trying to cook dinner and, you know, feed the dog and do all of these other things? So did I really take time to hear my kids, or even to just be with them for a little while and be conscious about giving them that time? Anybody else? I'll go with no, but feel free to interrupt. One thing I didn't say, but also is completely true: if you find what I'm talking about to be boring, feel free to interrupt me and ask about something else, because I'm easily taken off of topic and would rather you guys enjoy this. Spend your lunchtime talking about something that you find interesting. So absolutely don't let me bore you. If you take nothing else away from what we talk about today, these are in gigantic letters because I want you to remember these four things. We've established that children are people. So why do people do what they do? In general, it's for these four reasons. Now, it is not always just one of these reasons. Frequently, it is a combination of these reasons. So attention, right? Babies cry when they want to be held. Children might come in, run in after school and go, guess what score I got on my math test today? Because they want you to attend to that, right? They want your attention. The minute your attention's diverted, the phone rings and suddenly you've got to talk to somebody and your kid's going, mom, 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 hey, mom. And they haven't needed you for the last hour and a half. There's a reason, right? Your attention suddenly became less available and they were like, ooh, I want that now. Even though your attention was plenty available when the phone wasn't ringing. Escape. And this is true not just for kids. I want to be clear. I enjoy doing these kinds of talks because I like your guys' attention. I like being to see other people and talk about this stuff that I enjoy doing. So I enjoy the attention. Escape. This would be, in child perspective, I don't want to eat green beans. So I'm going to fall under the table and hide or flip my green beans onto the floor so the dog eats them. In the adult world, it might be, oh, my boss has been really terrible this entire week and I'm going to call in sick today because I don't want to deal with it, right? We all try to avoid things that we don't like, things that make our bodies uncomfortable, make our brains uncomfortable. Tangibles, that just means anything you can hold in your hand, anything that you can physically access. So that is our favorite foods, our favorite blankets, our favorite comfort items, our favorite type of music can be tangible. You can't hold it in your hand, but you do access it. Finally, automatic. This is the one that we don't have a lot of control over. And if a behavior has an automatic function, it is going to be much harder to change. The automatic function means that this behavior is occurring because something in my brain needs that to happen. And it might be that I'm running really low on dopamine, the happy chemical. And so I'm going to start exercising. I'm going to get up and move around a little bit. In a kid, it might look like wiggling in my chair because I've been sitting here too long. It might be that when I get really anxious, this was very true of me when I was younger, I'll chew my nails, right? Anybody else, fingernail biters or skin pickers, right? I found a little, I'm going to pick that until, oh, I'm bleeding and not even notice that I'm doing it. Because it's relieving some stress in my brain. It is doing something in my body that is helping me feel better, that is helping me manage that situation. And in children, this can look like a lot of different things because they're still figuring out those coping strategies. They're still figuring out what sorts of things make my body and brain feel better. So how do people learn? If we are assuming that children are people and that they're going to engage in behaviors based on those four things and a combination of those four things. Most people are going to learn by being shown how to do something and being given instructions. The older you get, the more the instructions can be effective. The younger you are, so those little kids really need to be shown, And then you do lots and lots of practice. This is true of every skill that you've probably ever learned. If you've ever had a job where they were like, here's the manual, go do this thing. And you're like, can somebody show me how to do this? Because I read it and I'm still confused. This is why, right? As people, we learn much better by watching others. We're really good imitators. Now, I want to put a caveat here that I am talking for the most part about kids who would be considered neurotypical. All of these same things apply to kids who are not neurotypical, ADHD, autism, developmentally delayed, but there will be some important differences. So if you have specific questions about that, just let me know. But they do apply to everyone, but neurotypical kids are going to be much better at imitating and copying other people than somebody who has significant neurodifferences. So then when we're modeling, giving instructions, we're trying to teach somebody something, we're going to slowly fade out that assistance over time. In my world, we call those prompts, right? So your boss might come in and say, hey, how's that thing going? You have any questions, right? They're kind of fading that assistance out as you're getting more comfortable with this new job or with this new task until you finally got it. Hopefully they're also adding reinforcement, either in the form of adding or subtracting. These terms get really confusing in my field. So when you hear positive reinforcement, I want you to think math terms. Positive reinforcement doesn't mean good or bad, just means I'm adding something. So that kid that came home and said, guess how I did on my math test, right? I got an A. If you add, buddy, that's amazing. Let's grab a popsicle. Come tell me about it. That's adding. You're adding attention and a tangible to them coming and reporting to you when things have gone really well, when they're proud about something. Subtracting that negative reinforcement just means instead you're taking something away. In reinforcement terms, that might mean, oh my gosh, way to go on your A, buddy. I'll do your chores tonight. You don't even have to do your chores. Do whatever you want this afternoon. I'm so proud of you. It's still reinforcement. It's not good or bad. I don't love the names of these terms, but we've had them for 50 years now, so we're probably kind of stuck with them. Think of them in terms of math. It's not good or bad. It's just reinforcement makes that behavior that you want to increase go up, right? So if I want my kid to come and tell me how things went at school more often, then I'm going to use either positive or negative reinforcement. I'm either going to add things following that when they do that behavior, or I'm going to take some things away that they don't like, right? Like chores or, it could be like, you get to pick what we have for dinner tonight, right? Some sort of privilege, some sort of, it was supposed to be chili night, but I know you're not a big fan of chili. Why don't you pick something else? You get a little of both, right? I'm subtracting the thing you don't really like, and we're adding in your favorite dinner. Punishment. And I want to caveat this with, I am not an advocate for any type of punishment that would not be considered legal or ethical, right? But we all learn through punishment. If I touch a hot stove and burn my hand and experience pain, that punishment, that added negative thing to me is going to teach me not to touch a hot stove again, right? These things occur in our natural environment all the time. If I start rambling about something that I really, really like, and my coworkers start to kind of avoid eye contact and start to look at their watches, I might pick up on that and go, okay, I've said too much, or I've started to ramble and people are looking to leave. I will probably be less likely to ramble about that specific thing at work in the future. Not that they intended to do that, right? Not that they maybe were even conscious that they were doing it, but that punishment decrease the chance that that behavior is going to be something I do again in the future. It's the same adding and subtracting. Positive punishment means I add something additional. So in terms of parenting, in terms of taking care of kids, it might be, hey, buddy, you threw that truck at your sister and we can't do that. So I'm going to have you help clean up the trucks and you're going to help clean up the dolls. I know you didn't play with the dolls, but this is your consequence for throwing the truck at your sister. That's an added positive punishment. I added an additional thing for them to do. Subtracting would be like, okay, you threw your truck at your sister. The truck's going to go in timeout. We're not going to be able to play with that truck today. Does that make sense? Usually I get a lot of questions about this. How's everybody feeling? Pretty good? Yeah. So why is this important? In behaviorism, we consider that most human behavior is communication, especially in children when they don't have all of those communication skills that as adults, honestly, we take for granted. We take all of these little tiny skills we learned as infants and toddlers for granted. That awkward stop making eye contact and looking at your watch stuff, when somebody's gone on too long about something is not something that we consciously think about, right? It's something that we have learned to do over time that gets someone to shut up, right? It gets someone to stop talking. It's very hard to work backwards sometimes. It's hard to think about those tiny little pieces of communication that aren't coming out of our mouths, that aren't words, but that if we consider that almost all behavior is communication, it helps us remember, okay, so why is my kid doing this? Why is my kid melting down in Walmart? You know, it can help you start thinking of these in a way that's like less about thoughts and feelings, which are valid and important, but very hard for kids to communicate, and get more into what can I do to prevent this in the future? What can I do to maybe alleviate this issue right now? If you think about what they're trying to tell me, what is my child trying to tell me through this behavior? It removes the blame. It removes some of that, both for the parents and for the kids. If your kid's the one screaming in Walmart on a busy Saturday morning, most parents are going to be embarrassed, right? That can be some of the most, you're surrounded by people and you just feel alone, right? Like, oh, what am I going to do? My kid is freaking out in the middle of Walmart. But it can take some of that blame off of you. It can take some blame off of the kid, right? To be like, why are you being such a spoiled little brat right now? Because they might be, but it might also be that they're hungry and they're tired and you've said no to 13 other things before the 14th no in Walmart when they finally couldn't handle it anymore, right? And so it pulls some of that away from anybody feeling guilty about the situation and thinking more in line of what can I do differently next time and what can I do right now, right? The kid's screaming on the floor. If I give in, does that mean my kid is more likely to scream and throw a fit on the floor in the future? Possibly. Yeah, it could. It could be reinforcing that behavior. So then you got to go, okay, is it worth it right now? Do I need to get out of this situation and give in a little bit right now? And then we work on preventing this and having a plan for this next time. And that is not an easy answer. It very much depends how many fits have we thrown in Walmart. Give yourself permission to change your mind. If you are stressed out, overworked, in the middle of Walmart on a Saturday morning with a little kid, and they're freaking out, and you have told them no, and you don't have it in you to work through that tantrum that day, if you know you don't have 30 minutes to wait for that kid to stop and calm down and be okay with you saying no, just give in. You're not going to ruin your child's entire life by giving them the sucker or whatever it is at the Walmart checkout line that they decided they absolutely had to have. Know what your capacity is for that day. Take my permission. And it does not matter what other people in Walmart think of you. It really doesn't. Get down there with your kid and go, hey, buddy, I didn't know this was that important to you. I changed my mind. Let's get that sucker. You get up, take a deep breath, and let's go check out. Right? It doesn't have to be painful. And if anybody has anything to say about it, just let it wash off, because they're not raising your kid. They're not in your house. They don't know all of the other things that you've been through all day or all week that has led you to that point where you go, you know what? One sucker's not going to kill him. It's fine. I changed my mind. I don't have time for this today. In the event that this is a frequent behavior, right? That we are tantruming to get what we want in Walmart every time. That's a different story, right? That if they are well-fed, well-rested, we haven't had this crazy busy day, all of their needs are met. and this behavior is still occurring, then we've got to do something about it. Then we've got to decide how we're going to consistently address this problem. Otherwise, I let it go would be my recommendation, right? Let it go as quickly as possible. You see your kids start to, and you go, oh, we're going to really melt down here, and I don't have it in me. I might lose my cool today. Just go ahead and, you know what? I changed my mind. Here you go. Cut that thing off before it even starts, right? We're going to go prevention here. You know what? I told you no to a lot of things today. Let's go ahead and get that sucker. The cool thing is that behaviors are going to respond to the changes in the environment. They're going to do that whether you try to make those environmental changes or not. And when I say environment, I mean everything. I mean the weather. I mean your mood, your tone, everything you say and do, everything your siblings say and do, everything their teacher at school says and does is all a part of their environment, right? The shoes that are too tight, but they didn't remember to tell you until they've worn them for 4 hours and you're out in the middle of the soccer field, right? All of those things are a part of their environment and are going to have an effect on their behavior. The cool thing is we can use that information to help our kids thrive, to focus on those things that we think are important, to focus on the things that we want to work on with our kids, and hopefully to help our kids work on the things they want to work on. So how do we do that? The biggest challenge is to identify that behavior that needs to change and why it needs to change. So what is the behavior that you're running up against every day, every other day, that's grinding on your soul? That is, that you're going, man, why does my kid keep doing this? And really spend some time looking at all of the surrounding things that happen when that behavior is occurring. If nobody has an example, I'll just pull one from myself. But if somebody's got, like, okay, I've got this behavior that's really grinding on me, let's go for it. Let's work our way through some of this stuff. Check in chat real quick. Okay, so my daughter gave me permission to use this this example. It is something we are currently working on. She hates, with a capital H, to have her hair brushed. And we have bought the special hair brushes with the bendy bristles, right? The stretchy ones that are supposed to be really comfortable. We have bought every spray, conditioner, and what have you to make the hairbrushing easier and less of a nightmare. And we have talked about how if you brush more frequently, it won't be so tangled and it won't be so much of a pain when you have to do it. We've done all those things and it is still a battle every day, usually twice a day, sometime with tears, to get through brushing her hair. Now, the reason that needs to change is because if she goes to school with absolutely horrible tangled hair, at some point, someone's gonna call CPS on me, right? Someone's gonna go, this kid's not being taken care of. Not every day. If she goes once in a while, we were late, we rolled out of bed and there wasn't anything we could do about it, nobody's gonna worry. But if we go to school every day looking like, you know, a monster has climbed out of her hair, there's gonna be trouble for me. On top of that, it's not a really fun way to start anybody's morning. It stresses me out. It stresses out my daughter. Nobody enjoys that thing. So that's my why it needs to change. Now, why does it bother her? Anybody think of our four possible reasons for behavior. Why will she scream and cry and throw an absolute fit when her hair needs to be brushed? So we've got attention, we've got tangible, we've got escape, and we've got automatic. Hard question, huh? Something's popping up in chat here. Let's see. Okay, so we've got an automatic. Anybody else? Escape. Escape or automatic. I think we're right on with both of those, right? It's something that she doesn't like, probably for a reason I can't see. There may be a reason that my daughter's scalp, pain receptors, something inside her body is more sensitive than mine. Something that I can't necessarily understand. You know, I've had kids grab whole chunks of my hair and yank on them, and I'm like, that's fine. I have a lot of hair, and I'm not really very sensitive to it being tugged or pulled on. It is not something that generally bothers me. Doesn't mean it doesn't bother her, right? Everybody's different. Everybody's body is different. Everybody's body receives information differently. And in my family's case, three of us, guess which ones, have ADHD. And with ADHD come some interesting characteristics in our brain, including how we manage things like pain. A lot of that is really not well understood yet, so I'm not going to be able to present any of that really. But what we know is she's receiving pain from this. She's telling us that it hurts. She's telling us she doesn't like it. And we have tried to make some changes in the environment with the spray-on conditioners, with the, I even bought those giant like wide tooth combs, but she's got this really fine thin hair that those just, they don't do much. We can get through really big tangles with them, but not those little bitty ones that like to hang out at the base of the neck, which is her particular area of hate to be brushed. This part right back here. So what do we do? If she's trying to get away from it, escape, right? With crying, with screaming, with literally running away from us when we say it's time to brush her hair. Then what can we do? The hair brushing has to get done. We have to do it whether she likes it or not. What are some other things we can do? Who's got recommendations for me? Silk pillowcase. I have heard that one. I probably need to look into that because it's the bedtime tangles back here that are really, really the challenge. But even just windy days with that really fine hair, she'll come home from school and it's like, what happened? We have been braiding it at night. That is one thing that we do is we'll go through it at night and braid it, and that prevents some of it. But with the spring sports rush that my family's been in lately, that hasn't been getting done as often because we're getting home at 9 o'clock at night. Hurry, hurry, get to bed, school tomorrow. So additionally, what we've really started to do is teach her to brush her own hair. Because if something hurts, there we go. If something hurts, she can stop and pull off faster than I can, because it's going to take longer for her to say, ow, mom, that hurts, my ears to hear it, my brain to receive it, and then my hand to stop doing that thing that hurts, versus her brushing her hair and going, ooh, that one hurt, and back off, right? She can respond to her own body signals better. I have also started using distractions when she cannot get through the hair brushing on her own, because currently, yes, she can brush her own hair, but it takes an hour and a half and lots of reminders. Because she has ADHD, because she's a little kid, she'll brush three strokes and then get distracted by something on the table or something her brother said, and we have completely forgotten what we were doing. So in those cases, I give her the screen time, the magic of screen time, right? It's the all-powerful reinforcer for a lot of kids. Normally in my house, we don't turn on screens in the mornings because we will never get anywhere on time. It is already a challenge. But that is just, we have learned in our house, the screens are not on in the mornings. I have had to break my own rule because we've got to get through the hair brushing one way or the other. So yes, you may watch a 10-minute YouTube video while I get through the rest of your hair and get it styled in a decent way for you to get to school. So they're helping. It's not 100% perfect. It's not all the time, but it's taken a lot of that everyday struggle out of our mornings that are already really hard to get through. So basically what we've been doing is teaching and reinforcing the new behavior, right, of brushing her own hair. And we're reinforcing replacement behaviors, allowing me to brush it. While I brush it, you can watch your show. It helps distract her from when I accidentally pull too hard on a tangle, that it's not quite as much of her focus if something else is taking away from that. And it's providing some reinforcement to just let me go ahead and do it for her. We're also doing that prevention piece that I've got here at the bottom, right? That's the brushing it at night, braiding it at night. The silk pillowcase would be an example of trying to prevent the behavior by preventing those tangles, by preventing the hair from being such a mess. And I will add that we have dance recital in, like, I think 3 weeks. And I have told her, because she has asked repeatedly now to cut her hair off, that she can cut it as short as she wants as soon as dance recital is over. I'm fine. It's hair. It'll grow back. I don't care. She's got beautiful blonde hair, but it's a mess and it's a struggle. And she has decided she doesn't like it or want to deal with it. Go for it. Let's do a bob. Let's see if you like it. So 3 weeks, we're cutting it off. We'll see. And I almost think that maybe a new start on hair might help some of those tangles just not be quite so bad. Sorry. It's not moving the slide. What do I need to do? There we go. Okay, so important things to remember. I hit on this a little earlier. Nobody is perfect. Neither your child or you. Don't expect perfection from them or yourself. Consistency is good. Kids need consistency. They need to know when they're upset, you'll be there for them. They need to know that you've got their backs. But also, if life is really out of control, if there's a lot of stuff going on at work, in your family life, in your house, you can let some things slide a little bit and it'll be okay. We can't all juggle all the balls all the time, and we'll all make ourselves crazy trying. So your kids will recognize that. Tell them that, right? Communicate that with them, that I'm stressed today. And so, yeah, we're going to have frozen pizza and ice cream. I didn't make a healthy meal. It's going to be okay. It's been a rough day. We're all busy. Same thing for addressing behavior. If you're consistent most of the time, if you've got to give in to prevent that tantrum or to get it to stop, I don't care what anybody in Walmart says, do it. Your kid will be okay. You are not spoiling them by occasionally going, I changed my mind. It's fine. It's really okay. Not every behavior needs to be addressed. If you're going, man, that one time my kid did that one thing that was super weird. If it's once or even twice, it's not a pattern. Kids do weird stuff. Adults do weird stuff. People are fun and wacky and weird. You don't have to come up with a plan for everything. Really prioritize those things that you think is going to help your kids thrive, that is impacting your family day, your classroom. If it is impacting it on a daily basis, those are the things we need to really move and make that plan on. The rest of them will just be fun and wacky and weird. Funny stories when they're grownups to tell their partners. Tackle those things that are most important. Let the other things go. Know when to let go. We talked about that already. Be aware of side effects. We have not talked about this. So reinforcement and punishment both have side effects if overused or used inappropriately. Punishment has more side effects and more serious side effects than positive reinforcement. So whenever possible, use reinforcement first. See how things go. Can I reinforce the behavior I want to see? Can I catch my kid being good? Can I catch my kid playing nicely with his sister instead of throwing a truck at her? And going, wow, man, you guys are playing nice together. Can I play too? Right? That will go so much further than the timeout, than the punishment. And there are so many fewer side effects in terms of punishment. Now, punishment's effective. It does work, but you need to know that if you're going to implement it, you should reserve it for the most severe, for the most significant behaviors that you're trying to change. And I'm talking things like aggression, right? Which is normal and natural for kids, especially we're talking toddlers, we're talking early preschoolers. They're not communicating well, especially when they're tired, grumpy, hangry, right? They forget to use their words and they use their body. They're communicating through their body. We have to teach them that that's not okay, but also know that that's completely normal for that age. Ooh, sorry. Got some sort of notification. Just make sure that you've tried the positive stuff first, because almost all behavior will respond to positive reinforcement. And if you reinforce that behavior, you've decided is the replacement, is the thing you want to take the place of the one that you don't want to see anymore. As long as you've reinforced that one enough, the other one's going to go away all on its own. It's really cool because they no longer need that behavior to hit that function, to get your attention, to get access to that thing that they really want, right? You've taught them a new behavior that works better, and you've reinforced it with those things they were trying to get anyway. That's how you do that with reinforcement without even having to address that, that problem behavior. Know when to seek help. If your child that you're thinking about right now has a behavior that is so significantly dangerous to themselves or others, that people are injured, that they risk injury, and I mean, like, gotta go to the hospital, gotta get stitches, gotta have really serious medical intervention, you need help with that. You need professional help with that. That is outside of the realm of what we are talking about right now, right? This particular topic, and they would, the person that you're going to get help from would talk to you about all of these same things, but they're going to come up with that very individualized strategy for that child, right? So we don't want anyone to get hurt. We don't want anyone to be injured because a kid is missing some skills, because a kid needs a different way to communicate what they need. And so know when enough is enough. Know when you don't know what to do next, because there are people out there who would love to help with that kind of stuff. I'm one of them. I get really excited when somebody's like, oh, I've got this really naughty kid I need your help with. Great. That sounds like fun. I love that challenge of helping that kid thrive and have more fun where they're at, because kids get to be kids for so little time. And then we all get to be boring adults. So as much as possible, childhood should be fun. And if I've got a kid in that big of a crisis, it's been going on for a while and they're not having fun, right? So really know when we're past the point of the stuff I'm talking about here and you need professional help. Most behavior response reinforcement, I said that already, but it's good to reiterate that punishment piece should be the last thing you try. When you've gone, I've taught the new behavior, I've reinforced the new behavior, but this other behavior is still popping up occasionally. And then it's probably going to look like a loss of privileges. For younger kids, it might be some sort of timeout. It might be an addition of chores. We use that one in my house. If I say, please go do your chores, and you say, okay, I might let you out of chores early. If you say, why do I have to do, I don't want, you're getting an extra chore. Right? Because I just need you to communicate with me more effectively. It might be, hey, mom, can I have 5 more minutes to finish my Minecraft? Right? But it doesn't need to be foot stomping, door slamming, teenage angst. So we're working on it. We're going, hey, do you think that was the right way to tell me you needed more time on your game? Could we do that differently next time so you don't have to do an extra load of dishes? Okay. Right? So yeah, it's not that I don't use punishment. It's not that punishment isn't going to happen, but it is that we make sure we're doing way more reinforcement. So those key takeaways are going to be, most child behaviors are a normal part of growing up. We all engage in behaviors that are shaped by our environment, by the people in them, by their behaviors. Always address the child's needs before worrying about the behavior. If you're in a massive meltdown with a little kid, have they slept? Have they eaten? Are they hot, cold, itchy, sick, right? How many times has your kid had a massive meltdown where you're like, what is happening? And then the next day they've got a fever or thrown up or something, right? They couldn't tell us what was happening in their body, but it all makes sense later. My kids did this a lot with ear infections. They gave none of those typical signs of ear infections, but if they cried over something really, really minor, I knew to take them to the doctor. Finally, make a plan for behaviors that need to be addressed. The ones that are affecting your day, the ones that are affecting your day all the time. But be flexible. Be flexible with yourself. Be flexible with your kids. If the plan's not working, then we need to reevaluate it. We need to look at, did I not pick the right function? Do I not have the right reinforcers? What do I need to do differently? Because this stuff works, but it's not easy. So the next question is just, what are you going to try this week? Is there any of this stuff that you think you'll be able to use?
Ashley, I personally like the negative reinforcement. We've always done positive. And my oldest girl, she actually is very well behaved, but she has a treat bucket. And every time she does something positive, I mean, she gets in the treat bucket all the time. I'm like, this is too much sugar. You know what I'm, it totally makes sense. And I mean, it's not necessarily rocket science, but I mean, I'm totally going to start taking things away and, you know, we don't have to get in the treat bucket 8 times a night.
Oh, and it blows kids away sometimes, especially if they haven't had much of it. A lot of times I'll consult with a teacher who's like, he won't do any math, any at all. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to say something you're not going to like, but bear with me.
Right.
I'm going to suggest to you, if you get this child to do 2 math problems, that you cross out the rest and go, great, you don't have to do the rest of these. And that kid's going to be so motivated by that. Right. And I mean, I'm not saying do that forever.
Right. I mean, if someone told me I didn't have to clean my kitchen tonight, I'd be like, oh, okay, sweet. Like,
right. Okay. If I could get somebody to clean out my car, I hate cleaning out my car. Right. Out of car cleaning for free card.
Right.
Let's go.
So I love the negative reinforcement. Thank you for that.
Absolutely. It's super impactful.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else got stuff they want to share or questions they want to ask? I think my next one's questions. Dance because I don't know what to do.
Well, if that's it, we can go to the final slide. And that is our thank you slide. First and foremost, Ashley, thank you for a wonderful, wonderful presentation. It was very informative and helpful and able to be useful for parents, teachers, people in the industry alike. So that was awesome. And to remind everybody, we will be sending out a follow-up email. Please take the survey if you haven't already. That helps us for our numbers and the ability to get grants to provide such wonderful presentation like Ashley's today. On that email as well will be a copy of the slideshow, as well as a link to the YouTube page that we will have this presentation up on. And so you can go back, and if you'd like to, recommend it to other colleagues, parents, anything like that, we'd love that. And we want to do our final thank you, and especially a big thank you for the Kansas Children's Cabinet and Trust Fund and an All-In for Kansas Kids Quality Subgrant. And then actually, that's not the final thank you. Our actual final thank you is to all of you for attending today. We appreciate it so much for taking an hour out of your day. And we hope you enjoy the rest of your Thursday and the rest of your weekend, and have a great day.
Thanks, everybody. I hope it was helpful.
It totally was. Thanks, Ashley.
Yeah.